We're going to join with all of our campuses in worshiping the Lord simultaneously this morning. Come on, we're going to sing of His grace. Oh, yeah. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Come on, sing this chorus. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that You would take my place, that You would bear my cross. You laid down Your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that You've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that You would take my place. I sing for all that You've done for me. Come on, He's worthy, church. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered. Come on, every voice. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. Come on, let's put our hands together. This is unfailing love, that You would take my place.
saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Yeah, that sounds great. We're gonna keep singing that. Every voice, let's lift it up this morning. Twas grace.
Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed.
Come on, we got one final verse. This is a good one. This is your chance if you haven't sang with us yet. Come on.
When we've been there 10,000 years,
yes.
Bright shining as the sun, we've no less day through singing God's praise than when we first begun.
We've no less day,
we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
Oh, your grace is amazing. Yeah.
And happy 150th birthday, Cross Church. What a day. What a moment. What a moment in the midst of the season that we're living in, right? We are so, so blessed, so very glad that you are here. You may have a seat. This is one of those moment Sundays. Only happens once every 150 years. And we want to soak it in. I hope that you enjoy it. We got a lot of special things for you, and that includes some special people who have come back to Cross Church. A lot of former staff members are joining us across the various campuses. I wanna just recognize this morning those who are on our Springdale campus specifically. They're to my left, to your right. If you are here visiting as a former staff member with your family, would you guys stand right now, let the church welcome you home and recognize you properly. Amen. So very good. And that's not all. We've got some more, but I'm going to leave those introductions for someone else. I do want to introduce to you one other staff, former staff member. He's headed this way now, the Reverend Matthew Stewart. Y'all give it up for Matthew. Matt, of course, grew up, born into Cross Church. I mean, there's not a much around here you hadn't seen, Matt. And grew up here, graduated from Shiloh Christian School, served on our staff team for a number of years. He's currently serving at Christ Community Church in Huntersville, North Carolina, just outside of Charlotte. And Matt, so very glad to have you, man. Welcome home. And so I'm gonna ask a couple questions. I want you to share a few moments of your heart, just some memories, some things like that. But talk to us just about what Cross Church has meant to you in your life and your ministry.
Well, when I think about Cross Church, I think first and foremost about the people. And the fact that I'm standing here today is because of generations of Lawsons and Stewarts specifically who joined this church back in the 1950s, and this has been their home church ever since. And as a result, my family grew up in church, and my kids have heard the stories about the years gone by and what happened at Cross Church and the times that God moved. And so there's a legacy that's been left, but not just by my family, but by the families that I grew up around. Looking out here today and seeing the faces of members who've been here for such a long time, you helped raise me. You helped raised my siblings. You've helped raise my kids. And I'll always be grateful for that.
Matthew, tell us one more time, just before you get out of here, if you could speak one word today to your church, what would it be?
Don't underestimate the value of long-term faithfulness to one local church. I think about seeing Pastor Ronnie here today and how for 33 years he pastored this church. I was sitting over on this wing on a Sunday night when I heard him preach the gospel and I gave my life to Christ. I think about the countless men and women who literally blood, sweat, and tears were put into this church. I think about the impact it's had on me, called to ministry, licensed to ministry, ordained to ministry, called to serve here at this church, sent out to pastor here, given a safe place to come home and heal when walking through a difficult season. But that's all because of the long-term faithfulness of brothers and sisters of my own family. And so when you think about your place here at Cross Church, think about what it's going to look like, not a year from now, 5 years from now, think about 50 years from now, your faithfulness here, what that will, that sort of impact will have on future generations, not only for you and for your family, but for the spread of gospel to the ends of the earth.
Amen. Amen. Great words. Would you all thank Matt for being with us again? Thank you, Courtney, his wife, for being here with him. And boy, I've got a very special presentation. I want you to direct your attention to the screens as another former staff member, not just any staff member, a former pastor of this church, had an opportunity to be with Nick Floyd, our current pastor. Look at this exchange on the screen.
Talk about the process of being called to the church all those years ago. What year was it when you were called? And give us the story behind that.
We came here, and you'll have to help me, 1970. I mean, from day one, it just been a blessing.
They called you, and you didn't feel like the Lord was in it because things were going so well at Grand Avenue.
The only way I can explain it is that God, in His wisdom and sovereignty, made this whole thing happen. We just have been kind of gone along for the ride.
What's one of your favorite things that you saw the Lord do?
We came at a time when there was a spiritual vacuum in this whole area.
Population of Springdale was 16,000 when we went there. And we had about 4,000 members, which was, you know, about a fourth of the town.
That's amazing.
It was just amazing. The Lord just took over. That's the only way you can explain it. And we didn't even know we were in revival.
We were sort of in a revival for about 10 years and didn't know it until it was over. In fact, it isn't over yet.
When you think about 150 years as a church,
yeah,
as one of the former pastors, what would you tell the church about the future?
Brighter than ever. Because of the area, for one thing. I mean, there's no limit. I don't think there's ever been a church do what this church has done. It's had good leadership all along the line, I think. God just saw to it. It's just a miracle place.
Is there anything else you'd like to tell the church?
I'd like to thank them for 16 wonderful years.
Pastor, talk to us. Talk to us about heaven.
I'm ready.
We both are. We're going to fly away together, maybe.
Yeah.
The Lord's been good, but we've lived a long, long time.
If you aren't ready, you better get ready because we're going soon. At least the opportunity will be there.
Stand with us as we continue to worship this morning.
How great the cast. the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. And through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Church, aren't you thankful this morning? Sing this with us.
Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven, 'cause the King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. We sing this together.
Sing it.
Then came the morning,
yes,
that sealed the promise.
We sing,
your buried body began to breathe. Then out of silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory.
church. You can have a seat. Jesus Christ is our living hope today. Amen. And at this time, I want to welcome all of our campuses at Cross Church. We are now linking in together across Northwest Arkansas, and we're so excited to be here at our 9:30 Springdale service. I know we have people in the overflow now at Springdale. We're linking in with Fayetteville, who I'm sure has overflow as well. We're also at the 9:30 at Pinnacle. And many of you who are still at home online watching, we welcome all of you here to church today. We are glad to have you as a part of our 150th anniversary. We got a lot of special things for you today, and I can't wait to unfold a lot of those things. But first and foremost, the most important thing today, I'm glad to welcome back a man who 34 years ago tomorrow became the pastor here at Cross Church, our pastor emeritus, Ronnie Floyd. Cross Church, get on your feet. Let's welcome him home.
Thank you so much. Oh, my soul. Our first Sunday back since May the 19th, 2019 seems like a lifetime ago. It's great to be back home. I've apologized to Nick every now and then, just saying, when I say our church, I said I'm not trying to, you know, say it's my church. I said it's our church. And even though our membership formally has occurred in a church in Brentwood, Arkansas, wherever we are, Tennessee, you know, we're really grateful for this fellowship always. And just as Cliff Palmer stated so well, thank you for 32 years and 7 months of investing in us and letting us grow up in this place. I wanted to be sure and work at 32 years in and 7 months just to be sure all of you knew, if you're new, that I was not the pastor here 150 years ago. But you know, you are a part of a church. I call it a whatever it takes church. I mean, this legacy of whatever it takes has existed for decades. I mean, we would do whatever it takes to reach people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And boy, we pushed the envelope a little bit some of those years. I mean, I remember the very first year we moved in this worship center, we had a crusade one night. Ended up, this dude was on every school you could ever be in Northwest Arkansas, which was open doors then. We had 4,200 teenagers here on a Wednesday night. I hope the fire folks didn't know about that. Over 500 teenagers right here on this stage. They came and they gathered here and they gave their lives to Christ. And they surrounded me all across the stage. Whatever it takes. Whatever it takes in building buildings. Whatever it takes to reach people. Whatever it takes to start a campus, even though we didn't have a clue what we were doing. But just whatever it takes, that's the heritage. That's the essence of who we are here at Cross Church. I mean, one time we even pushed it so much, I pleaded with the people, let's fast and pray for 7 days. We got some wild and crazy guys coming in here for a week, and they're going to do things we've never seen done in a worship center. But we're going to reach people for Jesus this week. Sunday morning was good. Sunday night, place was jam-packed. Monday morning, we got up, snow, inch after inch after inch after inch fell. I remember sitting in the Holiday Inn with our team, and we didn't know what we were going to do. Schools were closed. Everything was done. But we knew by what God had done that God was going to come through, and we heard the baby schools would open up by Wednesday. And what we did is we even planned two more matinees. And by the end of that week, thousands and thousands and thousands of people came in here night after night after night, unique people. By the end of that week, 2,600 people had prayed to receive Christ and 400 baptized in a week. Whatever it takes. You see, whatever it takes is because we believe deeply in a vision. And it's the vision that we believe Jesus has for all of us, is that we're here to reach every person for Jesus Christ in every town, every city, every state, and every nation. It reminds me of that powerful, powerful word that has really driven my life all these years as a leader. I cannot get away from it. Doesn't matter what I do and where I am. In fact, when I stood before you as your pastor 34 years ago, as a young man, I preached from this very passage. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. That's our heart. That's a whatever it takes attitude. Nothing Jesus did was safe. And nothing we ever want to do as a church needs to be safe other than providing people a place of safety to come. But this church is a church for those that are not yet here. We are not a country club for the saints, but we're a hospital for sinners. And we can never forget that in the heart of who we are. And why would we not have a whatever it takes attitude when over 75% of Americans today would not profess to have a faith in Jesus Christ like the Bible states, in a country with 329 million of us? And why would we not have a whatever it takes attitude when we live in a world with 7.7 billion people, and we know that 4.5 billion of those people would not also testify of a saving faith in Jesus like the Bible teaches? We know that less than 2% of all that 4.5 billion have never come to faith in Christ. Only 2% have. I mean, this is a whatever it takes church. I reflect upon this in closing today, and I hope you'll come back tonight as I share my heart with you in preaching the word. But just a quick observation from the book of Acts. When reaching people for Jesus is prioritized in the church, it always progressed beyond where it began. And that is so true today. It's so true about Cross Church, but it's so true about the church of the first century. Remember, Acts chapter 1 through chapter 7, the gospel went throughout Jerusalem. Acts chapter 8 and 9, it went to Judea and Samaria. Acts chapter 10 through 28, it went everywhere to the ends of the earth, and it's still going to the ends of the earth. And why would we not want to be a part of that vision? And that's why decades ago we determined that we are going to be a church with a vision that would be about reaching Northwest Arkansas, America, and the world for Jesus Christ. I'm telling you, we're not a perfect church. We never have been a perfect church. But I can tell you one thing we are. We are a church that believes in reaching people for Jesus Christ. And that's one thing we do well. But first above everything we do, first above all else, we preach good news to the whole world. That's what we do. Some things will not stay the same, as we all know. But one thing that will always stay the same in this church is the Bible will be preached from this pulpit as the Word of the living God. And we also know that when you cut us and you bleed us, sooner or later, we're going to bleed out reaching people for Jesus Christ, because we are passionate and deeply convictional that we're here to reach every person for Jesus Christ in every town, every city, every state, and every nation. That, my friends, is why the miracle continues here at Cross Church. I love you. Gosh, I wish I could see every one of you. Maybe I will. But thank God for you and blessings upon your lives.
When you see three lines on a page, what do you see? Do you see a road? Do you see a fence? Maybe you see some stairs or a window. But what if I joined them together like this? If I had showed you the cross first, chances are you would have never thought about three separate lines coming together to form something new. You would have simply thought, that's a cross. That's the way it is in life, isn't it? Once something becomes unified, it's hard to see it as anything else. You may not realize that, but you are a part of something that has been unified for 150 years. The year was 1870. Arkansas was still feeling the effects of the Civil War just 5 years earlier. 10,000 Arkansans had died, and millions of dollars of property damage left the state in turmoil. 6 men and 7 women came together against all odds in February of that year to start what was known as Liberty Church in a log cabin close to the town of Shiloh, which would later be named Springdale. The founders of the church were William Hunter, John and Louisa Ann Licklider, their daughter Margaret Licklider Baggett, sisters Margaret and Sarah Fitzgerald, Lorinda Baker Fitzgerald, Phoebe Lynch, who is a widow of a Revolutionary War veteran, Jesse Duncan, and her 3 sons, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob Lynch. William Blakely and Fanny Putman Mitchell, the daughter of the first pastor of Liberty Church, Bennett Putman, who began pastoring in April of that year. Brothers Abraham and Jacob Lynch had just finished fighting as Confederate soldiers in the Civil War, while William Hunter had served the Union Army in Illinois during the Civil War. 3 different lives, 3 different men, 3 different stories, and yet they came together in unity by the direction of the Holy Spirit for the sake of the gospel. 3 men who would have been pointing guns at each other just 5 years earlier were now linking arms to point the love of Jesus Christ outward to their community. That decision to be unified on February 19, 1870 changed everything and would mark the course for the next 150 years of our church. In the first year as a church, they added 23 new members and baptized 5 people. That's a 177% increase in membership right there. A year later, after they had outgrown their log cabin, Liberty Missionary Baptist Church, along with others in the community, built this building I'm standing in now. As one of the oldest buildings in Springdale, this could be viewed as the birthplace of Cross Church. However, the church quickly outgrew this amazing structure and began raising money to build our own building in 1895. About 15 years later, the church would be faced with one of her greatest trials. In 1910, there was a disagreement. 41 church members left to form the Second Baptist Church. Unfortunately, the list is long of cities that have both a First Baptist and a Second Baptist Church, all due to conflict However, the roots of unity were so strong in our church that not even the norms of society could separate us. You see, 4 years later, right after the start of World War I, the members who left to form their own church came back to First Baptist with 36 more people. You gotta wonder, man, what was the response of our church? Was it, no, we don't want you, or maybe it serves you right? You should have thought about that before you left. It was not that at all. Our church welcomed them back with great grace, love, and open arms. In fact, our desire for unity was so strong that that year it compelled us to join the Southern Baptist Convention of Churches in order to unite with fellow believers from all over the country. As the First World War ended, the outpouring of our church became greater and greater. We began to hold Bible classes in various parts of the city. We raised money to help other churches erect buildings and educate young preachers. And in 1924, we even loaded a rail car full of apples, potatoes, canned fruit, and other food, and sent it on to an orphanage in Monticello, Arkansas. During World War II, God poured out His Spirit on Springdale in some amazing ways. Citywide revivals saw hundreds of people saved, with over 115 people added to the church by 1944. From 1950 to 1960, the population of Springdale began to boom, almost doubling to over 10,000 people. Compelled by God's love, our church knew that in order to reach more people, we would need more churches here. This was not a culturally relevant move. It was a God move. Listen to this. In that decade alone, our church sent out almost 300 people to help plant three different churches in our region. After 100 years of ministry as a church, in 1970, Cliff Palmer became our senior pastor. As Pastor Palmer preached faithfully from God's word and challenged our church towards what he called lifestyle evangelism, the love of God was spread throughout our community in unprecedented ways. We began a children's bus ministry, a full daycare center, and an intercessory prayer ministry. We even founded Shiloh Christian School in 1976 with 180 students and 15 staff. As a result of all this rapid growth, the church voted to move its location from downtown to Johnson Road. Over $2 million was pledged to fund the first two phases of the building program. And then here come the 80s, quite possibly the greatest decade ever. The world gave us breakdancing, the Nintendo, the Rubik's Cube, Air Jordans, big hair, and if I might say so myself, some really cute kids. In 1986, Dr. Ronnie Floyd was called to serve as the new senior pastor of this amazing church. Only 2 years later, we dedicated our worship center with more than 7,000 people gathered to celebrate. In the fall of 1988, we hosted a crusade that saw over 600 decisions for Christ. And in December of that year, we held the first annual Living Christmas Tree. Under Pastor Floyd's new leadership of Vision 2000, the church experienced its greatest growth in 1989 and 1990 as we look to another decade. We started the Daystar ministry to reach people all over television. We started Warriors on the Wall prayer ministry. We launched Mission Northwest Arkansas. We started Blessing Baskets. We held evangelistic events with the Power Team. We planted churches on every inhabitable continent in the world as our pastor led us in prayer and fasting for the next generation. And so in 2001, Pastor Floyd shared a vision that seemed improbable, a vision of one church in two locations. Our desire to take the love of God to the world around us compelled us to rethink how we were doing church. With 125 years of unity under our belt, we set out to do something drastic for the sake of love. In 2001, we commissioned 400 people to Rogers to help launch the Pinnacle Hills campus. In 2008, our church baptized over 1,000 people across our two campuses. In 2010, we had a drastic change. We changed the name of our church to Cross Church. And a year later, we launched the Fayetteville campus. God moved powerfully during that first year, and we baptized 250 people at the Fayetteville campus alone. Over the next 9 years, our church baptized over 11,000 people for the glory of God. What a wonderful decade that was. And little did we know that God was about to bring some major changes our way as we launched into a new decade. On May 19th, 2019, Dr. Ronnie Floyd resigned after nearly 33 years to become the president and CEO of the executive committee of the Southern Baptist Convention, further demonstrating his desire into a new season to reach Northwest Arkansas, America, and the world. I was called and voted on to become the next senior pastor of our church. You know, it's fascinating to me that we have always been about the same things as a church, even though the methods might change here and there. We were putting differences aside to come together in 1870. We were giving sacrificially in 1895 to build our first building. We were committed to reaching the next generation in 1919 with the addition of local area Bible classes. We were feeding the hungry in 1924 with a railroad car full of food. We were already sending out people from our church to plant churches in the 1940s and 1950s. We have always been and will always be a church driven by love. As we enter into the decade of love, we must remember that we have always been compelled by love, and we must continue that into the future. Whatever the methods, whatever the cost, whatever the means, the world needs this message of the love of Christ more than it ever has right now. Let us join with 150 years of believers in unity, passion, and sacrifice for the sake of reaching people in Northwest Arkansas, America, and the world. Now is our time. Now is our future. What started 150 years ago and what has continued until now is nothing short of a miracle.
The miracle continues into the future now.
What will be the story of our church for the next 150 years?
Well, I want you to know I almost died for you on the roof. Trying to do a cool video for the anniversary and almost ended my own life there. Again, I want to welcome everybody from wherever you're watching. We're glad to have you on such a momentous day. I do hope you'll join us tonight. We're having what we call Cross Church Together, all campuses of Cross Church meeting together at one location. Obviously, we're in a COVID world, and so we'll put as many people as we safely can in a room, and then we'll move into overflow. But we want to encourage you to be here tonight at the Springdale campus at 5 o'clock from 5 to 6:30. If you don't know what the Cross Church Together service is all about, we run hard after the manifest presence of Jesus in this room. We've got some really special things planned for tonight. And obviously, like we said, my dad's going to be preaching tonight. I know he's got a great word for us. 6 weeks ago, I talked to you about the debt of the church. We were at about $4 million 6 weeks ago. And I encouraged us to make the 150th anniversary a goal of, man, let's knock as much of this out as we can. And so I'm real excited to let you know through the generous giving of a lot of people, through cost savings from on our behalf as a church and just other factors, today, as of Friday, the debt sits at the lowest it has sat in the last 15 years. We are at $3,096,000. And so we give God praise for all of that. And thank you to so many of you. God's continuing the miracle right now, even through that. You know, we're a part of a great church. I hope you realize that and know that. And God's done such an amazing work. It's shocking to think we've been around for 150 years. Not many things last for 150 years. But God in his sovereignty has placed this place, this church, this people, known as Cross Church, to be alive and well in this community for a long time. Today, I just want to spend a few brief moments with you on what I'm just calling an invitation to engagement. When I stood before you 6 weeks ago on Vision Sunday, knowing we had Vision Sunday and then the Vision Series and then today, I told you that this new decade, the next decade of our church, is an invitation for you to get involved. No matter where you are, no matter how long you've been at our church or how short a time you've been at our church, this is your opportunity to get involved. And so I want us to take a look back as we look forward. You know, America and even Northwest Arkansas is a vastly different place than it was in 1870. Think about what was going on in 1870. On January 3rd, construction of the Brooklyn Bridge began in 1870. February 3rd, the 15th Amendment to the United States Constitution was ratified, guaranteeing the right for African American men to vote. February 5th, the first motion picture ever was shown to an audience in Philadelphia. June 1st, we are told that the national census tells us that the United States population was 33.5 million people. June 26th, Christmas was declared a federal holiday. And listen to this one. November 1st, the National Weather Service issued its first weather forecast ever, it predicted a windy day in Chicago. Go figure. I don't really know if that was legit, but you know, a lot's changed, has it not, from all those years ago? Can you imagine those 13 names that I read off just a moment ago in that video, what they would think of today? By the way, I had to do several takes of that just to get all their names right. It's a tongue twister there. What would those 13 think if they walked into the campus at Fayetteville, at Pinnacle Hills, or right here at Springdale? They'd be shocked. How does that happen? How does a church survive for 150 years? And not only just survive, but here in our 150th year, thrive in the middle of a global pandemic? I would suggest to you that there are three guiding beliefs that guided these 13 people all those years ago that still guide us today and will guide us into the future. Here's what these three beliefs very quickly are. Number one is this: Jesus is the way. He is the way. And I would just say this way, there is no other way. There is no greater message that we uphold as a church than that singular doctrine that Jesus is the way to salvation. Jesus said it about himself this way. He said, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. Every generation in this church's history, from the generation of those 13 in 1870 to the ones that carried it into the 1900s and the 1950s and 2000s, and now here in 2020, every generation has upheld that theologically deep yet so simple belief that Jesus is the way. We're not saved by good works. We're not saved by baptism. We are not all on the path to God, just taking different roads. Jesus is the only way to salvation. And as a church, we uphold that primary doctrine of the good news that we are only saved through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ applied to our souls through faith. I speak now, when you think about it, it's very interesting. We have multiple generations represented throughout these through campuses, throughout all of you represented at home. But we are one generation of a church right here. And I speak to this generation in our church right here in the year 2020. Will we uphold that salvation is by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone? Today, if you've never met Jesus Christ personally and you're watching, or you're here at one of these campuses, I would encourage you at some moment today, just have a personal moment with God. Just say, Jesus, I believe that you are the way. Would you save me today? And Christ will save you. No matter if you're at home in your living room or you're here in one of these worship centers, Jesus will be the way for you. Our second guiding belief that has carried us for 150 years is this: the Bible is the Word. The Bible is the Word. We believe that the Bible, this book that I have today, the book that many of you hold in your laps or even on your phone, we believe it is the very Word of God to us. It is the authority for all of life. Many churches, since 1870, have bought not into upholding the Word of God, but into a doubting of the Word of God or criticism of the Word of God. And many of those same churches are now dead. And I might rightly add, and they rightly so are dead. Maybe you're even here today and you wonder, man, this Bible that y'all hold, how can we be sure that it's the same Bible that Jesus was trying to put together? And how do we know that this is what they had back then? I'd say it to you very simply like this. If God is sovereign enough to speak the very Word of God to us, then surely God is sovereign enough to preserve the Word of God for us. And here's a question for us. We can clap for the Word of God. Let's clap. We're gonna clap. Come on now. The question for us in our day is this: if God is sovereign enough to not only speak the Word of God and to preserve the Word of God, the question for us is, will we be bold enough to declare it as the Word of God and as the authority for our lives? Third and final belief that really carries us, defines us, guides who we are, is simply this: the Great Commission is the win. It's what my dad just talked about. I said, Dad, just give him 10 minutes to just reaching people. The Great Commission is, you know, for your family, you got to define what is a win for our family. What do you want your kids to grow up and be like one day? If you run a business, every business has to determine what is the win for our business. Well, I think the same is true for our church. We have to define what is a win. And we have been and always will be unapologetic about our desire to reach lost people with the good news of Jesus. The fulfillment of the Great Commission is the win. Can I remind you of this central scripture to our faith? Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Hear me loud and clear, Cross Church. Seeing lost people's lives changed, seeing new Christians be baptized, and seeing saved people be discipled. That was the win for Jesus, and that is the win for us. And without pressing forward towards this, even though we have survived and thrived for 150 years, if we neglect the third belief, we will die. You know, a lot of churches define the gospel rightly. Jesus is the way. A lot of people stand boldly upon the word of God that it is the word of God, the Bible is. But churches that die don't hold to the third one, that the Great Commission is the win. Church, we've always got to press forward. I love what Dad said. The gospel is always meant to go to the next person. We exist for those who are not yet here. This church is not for you. This church is not for me. It's not for any one of us. It's here for Jesus, and Jesus has called us to reach lost people. So if somebody were to ask you this week, they say, hey, I know you go to Cross Church. What's that church all about? I know you're celebrating 150 years. What is that all about over there? I want you to just simply respond like this. We believe Jesus is the way, the Bible is the word, and the Great Commission is the win. That's who we are as a church today. 150 years. That's a long time. We've now looked for the last 5 weeks at least what the next 10 are going to be about. We've called it the Decade of Love. 5 weeks ago, I gave you this card if you were in person here. In fact, we've got one of these on every seat. I want you to go ahead and grab this card right now. And I want to very briefly walk through this. We've been asking you over the last 5 weeks to pray about what are the lanes of love that God wants you to move into? And how does Jesus want you to serve him through this church? Let me very quickly give this to you. If you're online today, you can go to crosschurch.com/vision. We have an online version of this that you can fill in and turn in all there on your computer or on your device today. crosschurch.com/vision. If you look at the back of the card here, you have the four lanes of love. Let me talk to you very briefly about each one, and I'll be done. The legacy component is this, that we want to do all we can to leave a legacy of reaching the next generation over the next 10 years. We want to position the church also for the future over the next 10 years. You'll see there are three ways you can get involved. You can get involved through serving. That may mean, Nick, I want to be involved in serving through preschool ministry, children's and kids are the same thing, students, college ministry, or young adults. One of those five groups, you say, Nick, I want to be a part of reaching the next generation. You circle that if that's you. If you want to be a part of the prayer movement, you circle the prayer word right here. And maybe you want to be a part of the giving aspect of the legacy team. You can circle that. You may want to circle all three or two of the three. You're more than welcome to do that. The O is all about our obedience to Christ's commission. This is our mission's vision. Over the next 10 years, we want to strategically plant 10 churches in major cities around America and the world. We've already announced to you, our very first one is in London. We're asking 2,000 of you over the next 10 years to go somewhere on a mission trip. That may be to a part of Arkansas, that may be part of America, that may be somewhere across the world. We want to send 2,000 of you who would commit to that journey with the goal of sending out 50 full-time workers in the mission service. God's already beginning that process, by the way. The V stands for the vulnerable. If you want to be a part of loving the vulnerable in our community and world, we're focused on reaching the poor, the hungry, the immigrant, the prisoner, and the sick. You check that V box right there. And then finally, like we talked about last week, was equipping pastors and missionaries. If God's put it on your heart to be an equipper, an encourager to those who are on the front lines of serving God, you check that last box, and we'll get you involved in doing that very thing. As you leave today, you're going to have the opportunity at every exit, wherever you're attending church today, at every exit, there will be a tub. You just drop this in on your way out, very COVID-friendly, okay? Online, again, you can check those boxes. You can turn that in online. It's an invitation to engagement in the life of this church. Maybe today you've sat, and maybe you're newer to our church, or maybe you've been on the fringe of the church, and you see all the history, and you think, man, I wish I would have been further involved, deeper involved. Now's your time. You get to be a part of the next 10 years, what God is going to do in this place. We're going to close with a song today that really tells the fantastic story that we have to tell for the last 150 years of all that God has done. The central theme of this song is simply this: God has not failed this church. Isn't that true? He has not failed our church. He will not fail you. I hope this song encourages you today. Let me pray for us as we get set across our campuses for this final song. Jesus, we praise you that you are the ones who have held this thing. You are the one who has held this thing together. Not us, not pastors, not lay people, not staff, but you. We give you all the glory and all the praise that you have not failed us. And it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Dark, and it's hard to see what you are doing here in the ruins and where this will lead. Oh, but I know that down through the years, I look on this moment and see your hand on it and know you were here. And I'll testify of the battles you've won, how you were my portion when there wasn't enough. And I'll testify of the seas that we crossed and the waters you parted and the waves that I've walked. Oh, 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 my God did not fail. Oh, it's the story I'll tell. Oh, 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 I know it is well. Oh, 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 it's the story I'll tell. Believing gets hard of you when I can't see what you're doing. I know that you're proving you're the God who comes through. Oh, but I know that over the years, and I look back on this moment and see your hand on it and know you were here, yeah. And I'll testify on the battles you've won. when there wasn't enough. Testify on the seas that we crossed, the waters you parted, and the waves that I've walked. Oh, 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 my God did not fail, and no. It's the story I'll tell. Oh, 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 I know it is well. Oh, 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 it's the story I'll tell. And all that is left is highest praises. So sing hallelujah to the Rock of Ages, highest praise. All that is left is highest praises. So sing hallelujah to the Rock of Ages. Oh, you are the Rock. All that is left is highest praises. Sing hallelujah to the Rock of Ages. Testify of the battles you've won, how you were my portion when there wasn't enough, and I'll testify of the seas that we've crossed. And the waters you parted, and the waves that I walked. And oh, 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 my God did not fail. Oh, 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 it's the story I'll tell. No, I know it is well. Oh, 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 it's the story I'll tell.
Well, church, we really do have an amazing story to tell. It is a story of God's faithfulness and movement throughout 150 years. I hope today has been an encouragement to you. I hope you feel great about where your church has been and where we are headed together in the future. May God push us forward by His strength and by His power to show the love of Jesus Christ to people all over the world.